Greetings. That's right. You're with us live and in person. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your time. I'm George M. Matthews II. And you are streaming live with us as we are broaching our subject matter seen and viewed through the theme of our program, The Silence of Our Friends. That's right. The Silence of Our Friends. It was Dr. King who said, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. He said in another place, the thing that will be remembered in the end will not be the words of our enemies, but in fact, the silence of our friends. And then I like the third statement, and Dr. King had various quotes, all of which were magnanimous, all of them that I've been able to read over the years, were substantive. And he said the two greatest things in the world, the two most dangerous things in the world are when people understand these two, and I'll just take an excursion now for just a minute's time. When people understand these two factors, they understand and have a better grasp on the world. He said those two dangerous things are sincere ignorance. When people are ignorant, which racism is born out of ignorance, discrimination, segregation, Jim Crowism, all of the above are born out of ignorance. And sometimes that ignorance is sincere. Sometimes it's by default. It's what a person has seen. It's what they've encountered. It's what they've been taught, things they've been trained, so forth and so on. But he said the second thing is conscientious stupidity. Again, racism and all of its cousins and twins and quadruplets and so forth and so on are born out of ignorance. But there's a level of sincerity in some forms and facets of ignorance. And that's what we're here to do through this vehicle called The Silence of Our Friends. So as you're coming in, please do three things. A, share. Press the share button as you come in. And when you press share, there are others who perhaps are not aware that we're here each Monday, all other things being equal, at 6:30 p.m. Central Standard Time. And so when you press that share button, all the algorithms go to work for us to both notify people that we're here. And then secondly, of course, send out messages so that people who are not typically a part of our viewer slash listenership are alerted, and then they become members of the Silence family. That's right, SOF, Silence of Our Friends. I just made a short letter S, letter O, letter F. And then, of course, once you press share, also, if you're over on YouTube, please understand there are three options. You can copy the link. When you press the word share, it gives you the option of copying the link. If you so choose to copy the link, then you can start your own either messaging thread or email thread and send it out to friends and persons that you can personate. Or you can just press the word share and type in a name or names. And then, of course, YouTube will do the rest. If you're over on Facebook, follow all of our pages, our ministry pages. And of course, you type in my name. Most of that information will become available to you. And then type in the caption, the thumbnail title. It's already there for you, so you can see it as you're typing it. That's going to help everyone get involved with the program. Once you see it, by way of your eyes, once you are able to think it through by way of typing it in, then it's going to involve you. When only white is right, when only white is right. And the last time I checked right doesn't have a color or a race, neither does wrong. But when white only becomes right, and then to understand after the colon, race is deliberate. Deliberate competition. You see it there. And so type that in. Then as you're sharing, type in the word shared or sharing as you're doing it. Our brothers and sisters can catch the drift, catch the message, and do the same. And then, of course, get involved, if you will, in the topic by way of and via the comment section to chat. Say hello to a few people there and let me do that as we're coming in. We're here each Monday at 6:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, as I stated earlier, all other things being equal. And you all have been so committed, and I appreciate you so much. Cheryl Todd was the first person in tonight. Hello, Cheryl. Thanks for being there. Deborah Smith was the second. And then thank you for coming in. Good evening to you. Good evening, Beverly Thompson. Pastor Joanne Farrington is always in the top numbers of people coming in. So thank you for being there, Pastor. Theresa Thomas, always here, a resident historian. I respect her knowledge so much, and thank you for being here. E. Hale, that's Edna. Edna's here with us. Connie Demand, I saw all of these people, I think, yesterday. So thank you all for coming. Good evening, all who speak the truth. Thank you so much. I appreciate it so very, very much. Then Carolyn Banks, of course, thank you for sharing. Thank you for liking. That's right. Give us a thumbs up. Come in, giving a thumbs up, send out, use an emoji, shooting stars, hearts, thumbs up. All of that interaction helps to grow the channel. Teresa Johnson, thank you for being here. Edna Campbell, thank you for being with us. Phyllis Jones, hello to everyone. Thank you for coming. Let's see, who else do we have? Tanya Miles, blessings and good evening to you. Angela Carlisle, my friend and who lives in Tampa, Florida, or the surrounding area. Thank you, Angela, for being here. Tell your precious husband I said hello. Thank you. That's right. Remembering the life and legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, 1929 to 1968. The man wasn't even 40 years of age when he was, his life was terminated, ended. 38 years of age, I think, approaching his 39th birthday, something like that, if my math is correct and memory. JL Fumas is here. That's right. Dr. King's birthday, I think, is next week, the 15th, whatever the 15th is. And so I'm going to probably do something in that regard to commemorate Dr. King's stance and his impact on the world. Let's see. Thank you all for coming in. I appreciate you so much. Thank you, Stephen Wash, for being here. Blessings from Lima, Ohio. Thank you for coming in. Thank you, Angela. That's right. She's a very special person. And has always been, she and her family too, Judith and myself. So thank you all for being here. And as people are coming in, perhaps they, others will, hello, Linda Sanders. From about that same amount of time, Linda Sanders enters into the picture. So thank you all for being here. I appreciate you so very, very much. I want to add this to my Georgisms, closing Georgisms at the end, but I want to say it now. I was thinking Thursday, Friday, or Saturday that speaking out is not a crime, but withholding the truth is. Speaking out is not a crime. That's not where the crime is. The crime is when people withhold the truth. And so I want to get into it tonight. Again, when only, quote, end quote, white is right. This is part two. Race is deliberate competition. We come in with the theme song, Lift Every Voice, because all of the things being equal, everyone has a voice that needs to be lifted. And then the lyrics present themselves to us till earth and heaven rings, which means there has to be a symphony between the mindset of heaven, the right and righteous mindset of heaven, until it finds its place in the earth, affecting racism and racial tension, which the church is placed in the earth to do. That might be new news to some, but it is very true. Sing with harmony, joining with others who have the same cause of distinction. sing with liberty, which is a non-ending purpose. Lady Jones is coming in. That's our friend from McDonough, Georgia. Thank you for being here. I'm Georgia Matthews II again, the egalitarian. And an egalitarian is a person who believes in, is in support of, speaks to the issue of equality of all people. It's a mammoth task, a mammoth subject, but it is one in which all of us, I feel, are called, asserting, resulting from, or characterized by the belief in the equality of all people, the blacks, the browns, the bronzes, white-skinned people, without regard to anything other than the Creator's focus, which was illustrated in the fact that through one blood, He created all nations. And again, every system, we have to understand that with regard to systemic as well as systematic racism, every system is designed to get the results that it yields. A system is created. A system is a brainchild of someone or something. It doesn't just evolve. Systems don't just pop up, simply appear out of nowhere. No, they're hatched. They're the brainchild and children of people's thought processes. And so every system and then the system of racism tracks the results that it is designed for, which is designed. And those results are limitations, marginalization, control, and to leave Black, bronze, and brown people out of the equation. To leave Black, bronze, and brown people out of the equation, to cause the world to run without the influences, the touches. When I say the world, I mean the world system. I'm talking about that of religion, family, education, government, media, arts, and of course, business. Proverbs chapter 9 tells us that every civilization has seven pillars, P-I-L-L-A-R-S, upon which that civilization, that culture, those cultures, if we speak in plurality, are founded, find themselves cemented, if you will. And so this culture, particularly these states that are yet to be united, have been set up in a way, and from its very beginning, from its very inception, 1619, when the 20 and some odd freed persons from the continent of Africa were imported against their own wills into this country for the specific cause to be slaves. They were not slaves when they were brought here. They were made slaves. They were free people in their own country. And so in the 1600s, and again, the church was here when the early settlers came to colonize this country. They brought church with them, quote unquote church. And so how could the church then, as the church is now, be so blind and so silent not to lift up the voice? Remember, I told you once, I'll tell you again, God only has the voices of humans in the earth. God only has the arms and legs and ingenuity and the intelligence, if you will, of people in the earth. He works through people. And when people have made a decision to be silent, as Albert Einstein said, if I am silent in the face of criminal activity, then I'm complicit. Yes, when I should speak, and if I am silent, then I am guilty of complicity. Let's move on. I've told you about the seven mountains or systems of influence that shape the world. When we talk about the world, we're talking about a system, the system of religion, the system of family, the system of education, the system of government, the system of arts, media, and of course, business/economics. Here at The Truth, the Silence of Our Friends, we agree and support the aphorism, speak the truth, even if your voice shakes, if your knees knock, or if your liver quivers. I didn't see A.B. Jones. She always types that in before I can get to it. I love it. Frederick Douglass once said this, and I agree with it wholeheartedly. Knowledge makes a man unfit to be a slave. You can only enslave a person who is otherwise free by removing knowledge from him, absenting his mind from the association with knowledge, disassociating him with information that would bring him into knowledge. I said to you once, I'll say you again, challenging racism, although in many minds it's the contrary, but challenging racism does not make one a racist. No, in fact, it does not. We're not here to talk about a building or religion or even people, but principles. Principles answer the question, not who is right, but what is right? Someone should type that in the comments section. What is right? Question mark. What's so hard about that? What is right? Not who is right. Not whether it's the Democrats or the Republicans or some other independent group, but what is right? For goodness sakes, all we're here to deal with is what is right. What is right? It doesn't have a color. It doesn't have an educational margin. The answer to that question doesn't have a background. It doesn't come from a particular zip code or the lack thereof. It's just a principle, the principle of what is right. I've told you once, I'll tell you again, education always makes room for the discomfort that it brings. Some subjects in life are uncomfortable, but the educated mind, when enough light comes, it makes room for the discomfort that education brings. Faulty leadership is attempting to lead others with no relevant voice on pertinent issues which affect the lives of the masses. In other words, a leader cannot choose where his or her voice can be placed. If you are a leader, whatever things affect the masses, your voice is to weigh in, to give guidance, to bring light. As a matter of fact, I want to throw this particular passage of scripture. We talk about the metaphors of scripture, Jesus in the beautiful attitudes, otherwise known as the Beatitudes, makes the statement, you're the salt of the earth. That's a metaphor, but we have the influence of salt. Salt influences food. It makes itself known. How could we get that twisted and come so far apart and separate from what it was that Jesus said, that the church is to salty the earth, not the church itself, but the church provides influence to the world in these seven pillars of influence that make up the world's system. He says that salt is found everywhere. It's undeniable, unmistakable, can't be confused with its near twin cousin, if you will, sugar. It's very definite. It's a preservative. Blood has a certain amount of iodine or salt-like saltiness in it, if you will. If you ever tasted blood, you pick up that very definite taste. It's in water, salt water. It's everywhere. It's in the universe. And so it is with people who are believers. Their influence, which is the influence of God, the mind of God, the voice of God, the touches of God, the legs of God, the feet of God, go into places to present the answer to the question, what is right for God, on the behalf of God? We are to do that. We're to be impactful in the world system. And he says, if you lose that saltiness, that influence, you're good for nothing. How did we miss that as church people, if you will? But to be cast out and trodden under feet men. Then he says, you're the light of the world, not the light of the church. The light of the world. We come to the church, all other things being equal, to get the light, but then to take it back into the world. And so here we are. I did not know last week, but I want to give you the quote again. The world got doing without race for the overwhelming majority of its history. The world did without race for the overwhelming majority of its history. The U.S. has never been without it. The U.S. has never been without it. It's always been a subject of race. I'll get into that in a minute's time. Race is any one of the groups that humans are often divided into based on physical traits regarded as common among people of shared ancestry. So you begin to group people into certain associations based on their skin color, their hair type, so forth and so on. Race. Race, by another definition, is the fact of dividing people. It is an instrument, a man-made instrument. And someone should type that for me in the comment section. Race is a man-made instrument for division. It is just that simple. It's a man-made construct for division and otherwise for competition. The fact is that race is defined as the fact of dividing people or of people being divided into such groups or categorization by groups by way of distinction. Race is a contest in the running of horses. God only made one race, and that is the human race, as opposed to races. Races gives birth to racism and racists. But God made the human race, one race, and it's the human race. Races divide causes multiple, I don't want you to hear this because I'm going to come back to it. Race, by definition, causes multiple rules segregating entities, i.e. countries, groups, cities, schools, finances, impacting each of the seven mountains of influence. And so as I opened the program, speaking to tonight, when you talk about race, you're talking about causing separate rules. It's kind of like moving the goalposts. If you say for one race, this is what it takes, A, B, C, to be successful. And then to another race, it's D, E, and F. And then to another race, it may be X, Y, and Z. And then as those particular races who are not the majority race begin to ensue or pursue the end game, the goalpost, and whoever's in charge, the majority, move the goalposts. And this is what happens. And this is what the church was supposed to weigh in on and defeat. Now, I want to give you, those were the nouns forms of the word race. I'm going to give you the verb forms. In other words, God never heightened on the word race to describe mankind's ethnic groups or ethnicities, because race as a construct has various synonyms. For example, a race is a battle. So when you talk about the races, you're talking about battles between ethnicities. It's just that simple. Race, another verb form, is compete or competition. This is why you have certain groups competing by any means necessary, lying included, to marginalize, hold back, limit other races, because it is a competition. The word race means contend or contention. It means a face-off, a fight, a rival, or to vie, the IE. And so I'm going to play this clip for you, Mr. Engineer, if you get it ready for us now. And I want you to notice the, let's play the clip. I want you to notice certain distinctions. First of all, look at the network that produced this clip. Then, of course, listen to the clip. All right, so the network will be identified, I think, in the top left. Listen to the clip. Then look at the bottom scroll or the end cap or the bottom cap that tells, it says that coverage, that of coverage in the spirit of faith, as to make it sound like the thing that is being reported and the comments of the commentators is coming from the angle of the spirit of faith. And what we're talking about is this particular network's support of now Governor Ron DeSantis from my home state of Florida, I'm ashamed to say, because of his leadership. Let's go, Mr. Engineer, if you will, play the clip.
Ron DeSantis, as you heard a moment ago, sworn in yesterday, and he has basically declared war on wokeness. Why aren't more Republican governors taking that very action?
So good news, Sarah Sanders will be sworn in on January 10th. She's going to be, I think, potentially the next education governor and have a lot of opportunity to expose wokeness and move Arkansas forward. We have Governor Greg Abbott, who I've heard is doing amazing things, looking at immigration, looking at school choice as well, and education opportunity. His inauguration and swearing in is January 17th. We have Governor Kim Reynolds. So I think this is the very beginning. I think that Governor DeSantis is actually putting a very high bar for these other Republican governors, and I can't wait to see what they're going to do.
Okay. What did you hear? What did you hear? Okay. I'll tell you what I heard since you're asking. What did you hear? I'm waiting for you all catch up with me. What did you hear? First of all, did you notice the network, the Victory Channel? You all aren't talking back to me. Did you notice the network? The network, the source of that clip came from Victory News, produced by the Victory Channel. Now, I'm not going to call names just yet, but I noticed in the Bible that, you know, Nathan called King David's name. I noticed in the Bible that Paul called Peter's name, and he said because he was wrong in Galatians 2. I noticed that the Apostle Paul, by the time you get over to 2 Timothy, called a long list of people, Alexander the coppersmith. He talked about Hymenaeus, he talked about three or four different people. He called their names. So there is a place when you're correcting error where names have to be called. I'm not going to do it tonight, but there is scriptural support. You know, Jesus, I'll just get to that in a moment's time. Coverage in the spirit of faith, ? Yes, that's what I wanted you to see. That's one of the things I wanted you to see, Deborah Smith. Education plans for schools. That's right, Theresa Thomas. So that means we need to look back and see what his agenda is regarding education, since the spirit of faith, this faith channel owned by one of the giants in the faith, one of the giants in the faith's ministry, is pushing Ron DeSantis, who is out of control, an out of control MAGA Republican. Yes, the model Republican governor. That's what she said. That's something else I heard. What else did you all hear? See, these are the kinds of things that people in the Christian community, we've been taught, we've been kind of sedated to be alive with our eyes open, but never pay attention to things that are happening in plain view. All the while, these people have a long game to extrapolate, to steal good gains that God has blessed us as a people, black, bronzes, and browns, to receive here as far as rights are concerned. These people have a game to steal it all back. Let me take you into it. So I want you to do some research and find out who owns or what ministry owns the Victory Channel. Then you notice at the very bottom, I see Pastor Joanne Farrington. That's right. There you go. She has the initials there. But some of you'll do your homework and you'll find, these are guys that are lining up behind. They lined up behind number 45 in the person of DJT, former president. They're lining up behind everyone who walks in this level. All right. Then at the very bottom of the news clip, they identified the reporting and reporter as coverage in the spirit of faith, as if to say God is backing what it is their network is backing. And in this case, it was governor of Florida, Republican governor Ron DeSantis. And then they said that he is going to expose, I did a program on this and some of you have probably forgotten it, exposing wokeness. In other words, they don't want you. It's like DJT said, number 45, he said, I love uneducated people. I love the uneducated people. And the reason that he loves uneducated people is because, in his own words, you can tell them anything and they'll believe you. They don't do research in many instances. They've been taught to be researchers, to go and check the thing that is stated out as being truth or fiction. And they said he's going to expose wokeness. They don't want us to be woke, to be aware of the facts. They don't want a people to know what is going on. They don't want people to have insight, to be able to be discerning, to be pillars of truth. They don't want that. This is a church network. This is the body of Christ. These are my precious white evangelical brothers who have already cast their lot fully into, while they've been good teachers of balanced evangelical teachings, they have opened our eyes to some things that we heretofore up until now didn't see out of the scriptures. The good Bible teachers have come from those particular disciplines. However, with all of that said, when you are wrong, there's no such thing as white wrong or white right or black wrong and black right. When you're wrong, you're wrong. And when you're right. And it's regardless of ethnicity. So they said, the reporter said, DeSantis is the beginning. He's going to set a high bar for other Republican governors. And so people haven't said a word about it. Let's look at the political positions. We have to talk about this because these fellow brothers and sisters in the gospel of Jesus Christ are making it appear that because DeSantis is white, regardless of what he says, as they supported DJT, and they made it look this way, that when you're white, whatever you say, whatever you do, however you say it, whether you line up completely with the word of God or not, it's automatically right. You see, these people have an agenda to take from the body of Christ, to take from the states that are yet to be united, the most fundamental effect that God gave human beings, and that is that of free choice. God gave up the entire planet to illustrate how much he desired that humans' choices are not controlled. God didn't even do it when it came to the only two children he had on the earth at the time, which were Adam and Eve. And they relinquished the entire globe to God's arch nemesis, Satan. And God did nothing to prevent it because he has underwritten in man free choice. God will give up ground to protect man's freedom of choice. Doesn't make the choice or choices right, but there's a party of people, there's a demographic of people who want to control the choices of others, as if to say God cannot get in the heart of his own people and legislate, bring us to a place of seeing the difference between right and wrong. That's God's glory, is to bring people into an understanding of that which is right or that which is wrong. It is choice. Adam and Eve had it. God protected it. They made a wrong choice. We've been in shift ever since. But that's the way it is. Choice. And so these people have an agenda to control the choices of other human beings, particularly black, bronzes, and brown people. It's always been that way in this country, and the church is supposed to take a stand against this. The political positions of Ron DeSantis have been recorded from his 2012 United States House of Representatives elections and his tenure as representative, the 2016 United States Senate election in Florida, and during his tenure as governor of Florida. He supports the implementation of a medical marijuana program in Florida, but opposes legalizing recreational marijuana. And the reason for that is because more Black, bronze, and brown people are in prison now because of the recreational use. Doesn't make it right to recreationally use marijuana, but these people know that on the other end of keeping recreational use of marijuana as a crime, a federal crime, it will lead to Black, bronze, and brown people continuing to be criminalized and as a result given long prison sentences. And so that's a demographic of people that are out of the way. In May of 2021, he signed into law a bill that prohibited businesses, schools, cruise ships, and government entities from requiring proof of vaccination in the midst of the height of this global pandemic, global crisis. He signs a bill into law that no longer was vaccination certification or vaccination passport legal. And so he lined up directly behind number 45, DJT, in bearing the brunt of causing more people to be impacted by this notorious virus and consequently die because they perpetrated that it wasn't real. In September 2022, as governor of Florida, DeSantis requested for, please hear this and see the hypocrisy, federal disaster relief for Florida due to the impact of Hurricane Ian. And you remember the devastating impacts of Hurricane Ian just September or so, September, October last year, just a few months ago, arguing that in spite of living in, quote, a very politicized time when people are fighting for their lives, when their whole livelihood is at stake, when they've, and this is a direct quote, lost everything. If you can't put politics aside for that, then you're just not going to be able to, end quote. However, previous to that, January 2013, after DeSantis had just been sworn into the House of Representatives, he voted against providing federal disaster relief for Hurricane Sandy to the impacted states of New York and New Jersey. You'll remember that. DeSantis stated his rationale as being that of increasing, quote, federal debt by another $9.7 billion with no plan to offset the spending. In other words, he wasn't concerned about human life a few years before, but then when it came to his state, he went there with his hands out because it was political expediency. It doesn't prove that his heart is for people as it wasn't in 2013. It only proves that these people are so hypocritical, they'll do anything to prove politically correctness or political correctness. Is white only right? Who is there to say this is wrong? It's hypocrisy. Everyone stop what you're doing now. Give us a thumbs up. Give us a shooting star. Use an emoji. Give us a thumbs down. Something to track us and help me track with you that you're still with me out there. DeSantis opposes federal education programs. This is why the reporter on this particular news clip said that XYZ person is probably going to be the next education governor. Watch this, or the next education cabinet member for DeSantis. DeSantis opposes federal education programs such as No Child Left Behind. And wait for this one. He opposes race to the top, saying that education policy should be made at the lower level. In June, stay with me, in June 2021, DeSantis led an effort to ban the teaching, wait for it, in the back left of the room, of CRT, critical race theory, which is only their uneducated understanding of, they can't even explain it. Critical race theory is not taught in high schools. It isn't taught in middle schools or junior high school, as it was in Florida, where I'm from. critical race theory is a college course. It's a college education course. And for the most part, if my memory serves me correctly, it's really only offered to people who are pre-law or in law school. The point of the matter is critical race theory is really Black history, if we kept it simple. It's the actual truthful history that happened. For example, in my home state of Florida, which I'm ashamed to say, by way of its current governor, who is Ron DeSantis, today, I believe, marks the 100th anniversary of Rosedale. Now, I'm going to do a program. Graduate School, Theresa Thomas. Okay. It's a college level course. I know that. So thank you for the correction. She's saying what I'm saying. Grad school. So it's post the 4-year degree. So it's an advanced course, critical race theory. So critical race theory delves into how slavery, for example, the impacts of enslavement, Black slavery in America. How does it impact these seven mountains of influence? How does it impact politics? How does it impact the church? How does it impact families? How does it impact business, economics? How does it impact media and arts and so forth and so on? And then Rosedale, as I was about to say, it's a little town. I think it's outside of Daytona Beach. It's in that area. It's like Central Florida, maybe before you get to Orlando, and where you had a white woman allege that she had been assaulted by a Black male. And Rosedale was the equivalent of the Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma, which had its 100th year anniversary of that massacre maybe a couple of years ago. So the same thing happened. There were like probably 10 or 15 different massacres that were white led that broke down the economic development post-slavery. So during the short-lived time of Reconstruction in this country, when there were a number of political persons of color who were elected into office after Black males were given the right to vote. That's a conundrum, given the right to vote. But anyway, and Black people begin to, out of their own sense of survivalship, without the 40 acres, without the mule, simply being let go and left in desperate, dire means, begin to build, because that's who we are as a people. And that's why some other demographics are so afraid, because if you give people of color, Black, bronzes, and brown people, a little wiggle room, a segue of education, some light of hope, of ingenuity, their natural creative ability will come out. And that's one of the reasons why I'm here tonight, is to encourage that. Yes, it's American history, including Black American history. Yes, in fact, but it really critical race theory, Theresa Thomas, if you track with me, delves more into what they're more afraid of, let me say it that way, is how the Black history impacts their heinous actions against Black people, how historically Black, bronze, and brown people have been impacted by their white counterparts. And they don't want their children through being educated to understand what really took place. It's just history. It's the truth about history. All right, let's get back into it. DeSantis opposes federal education programs. I told you about that. He opposes the teaching of critical race theory in Florida public schools, though it had not ever been a part of Florida school curriculum. I wasn't taught that in school systems through which I matriculated in Florida. He described critical race theory as, and here's my verification, Theresa Thomas. He described critical race theory as, and I quote, teaching kids to hate their country, when they understand the heinous activities that were carried out, their fear is that their own children would ask the question, how could their own forebears have been this malicious and malignant? I'm coming through. December 15, 2021, DeSantis announced a new bill, the Stop Wrongs to Our Kids and Employees Woke Act, which would allow parents to sue school districts that teach their children critical race theory. Is right only right when it's white? Race is a deliberate set of competition of people of color. It is plotting people. It is designed to cause people to compete against each other based on the color of their skin. The bill is designed to combat, quote, end quote, woke indoctrination. Just being aware of the truth. They call it being woke, the derivative of being awake or awakened. We just make it short and call it woke. There you are. There you have it. And they're critical. They don't want people to be woke. They don't want programs like this. They don't want leaders to speak out and call people's attention to right and wrong. They don't want that. The bill is designed to combat, quote, end quote, woke indoctrination in Florida businesses and schools by preventing instruction that could make some people feel that they bear, quote, personal responsibility, end quote, for historic wrongdoings because of their race, gender, or national origin. They do. And this is why we are due, Black, bronze, and brown people, as other demographics have been paid reparations. We are due that. And had they come 100 years ago, 150 years ago, the country wouldn't see the plight of Black, bronze, and brown people as they're seeing it today. I want to show you something. Mr. Engineer, if you would do me a kind favor and just put up the picture of Congressman-elect George Santos. Now, he sounds like DeSantis. That's D-E capital S-A-N-T-I-S. But this last name spells S-A-N-T-O-S. There are no relation except by way of their own spirits. This man is in lockstep with DJT, who has recorded, according to the New York Times and the Washington Post, I've done programs on the same, over 30,000 lies while he was in political office as the president, then president of these yet to be United States. God only knows how many he's really told, but they are recorded and tracked over 30,000 lies. This man, the white lies, this is according to the New York Times article, it's a piece I read dated January 6th, 2023 by its author, Nicholas Fandos, F-A-N-D-O-S, The White Lies of Congressman-elect George Santos. And he calls him the lying congressman. George Santos is stretching the tolerance for lies in U.S. politics. I'm going to run through this because I want to get to something else, and I have just a few minutes to get there. We've been accustomed, and I'm reading this particular article. We've become accustomed in American politics to a certain level of truth stretching. Politicians contort facts to justify their plans. Some polish the rough edges of their resumes or inflate military credentials, hoping no one notices. Notoriously, and I'm just reading the article, Donald Trump's falsehood-filled presidency ended with a massive lie. Please hear this, with a massive lie about the 2020 election. By even the standards of this era of self-aggrandizement and alternate facts, lies, it's hard to find a case quite like that of George Santos, the newly elected Republican congressman from Long Island, that is New York, as a recent investigation by my colleagues, Grace Ashford and Miguel or Michael Gold found, Santos did not seem to so much embellish his biography as make it up. Degrees, tragedy, religious faith, job credentials, even charity. You're gonna want to stick around for this. White skinned people. Now he's probably Latino or Hispanic, otherwise Hispanic, but he goes under the banner, and this is what happens when people have white skin. They associate themselves with the privileges of white skin. Now, bronze, brown, and black skin people can't do it because of the color of our skin. This is what race does. It establishes different principles, different echelons of right versus wrong. It makes allowances. It makes conveniences. It speaks truth only when truth is beneficial. It makes hypocrisy no longer hypocrisy. It devalues things that are. You see where I'm going with it. I need to go here. Quote. Politicians don't tell the truth. Sure, nothing new. Everyone says that, end quote, says Katie Sanders, the managing editor of PolitiFact, 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 a widely respected nonpartisan fact-checking service, quote, but to be this brazen is unlike anything we've seen in recent memory, end quote. The most vexing question, though, may be what happens to Santos now. He has refused to step down, and his own party has shown little appetite to force him out, particularly amid an ongoing House leadership fight. His activities may yet lead to criminal charges, but short of prosecution, the case is shaping up to be a test of voters' tolerance for falsehoods. Even in the post-Trump political environment, Sanders called it, quote, a huge moment for truth and lies. And I'm going to add this word, white lies, in politics. And I'm going to add the phrase as well as in the rest of the world. As a candidate, Santos presented himself as a compelling political figure, a young gay conservative financier with deep connections and family wealth. Voters in his suburban New York district responded, delivering him a nearly, wait for it, 8-point victory in November over a Democrat, Robert Zimmerman. In the weeks since, nearly every major point in Santos's biography has unraveled. That means he lied. Santos also wrote a position paper shared with pro-Israel groups, including American Israel Public Affairs Committee, AIPAC, in which he identified, quote, end quote, as a proud American Jew. Several outlets, including The Forward and CNN, looked into Santos's mother's heritage and found no evidence of Jewish ancestry. This man lied about who his mama is. If you lie about who your mama is, what won't you lie about? He said his mother was of Jewish ancestry, and she wasn't. She isn't. Santos's maternal grandparents were born in Brazil and have no Ukrainian or Jewish roots, according to genealogy websites reviewed by The Forward. He claimed that he graduated from Baruch College, then worked at Citigroup and Goldman Sachs. But Grace and Michael found no evidence that he received a college degree or worked at either financial giant. In fact, wait for this now. At that time, he worked as a customer service agent for Dish Network, the satellite company. I'll just give you a minute to wrap your mind around that. And now here he sits in the Capitol in Washington, D.C., stair-stepped there by the invisible trellis or stairways of lie after lie after lie. But he's white-skinned. Santos claimed to have founded a tax-exempt animal rescue charity that saved more than 2,500 dogs and cats. You lied on your mama. You lied on your grandmother. You lied about your education. You lied about your previous employment. You lied about your work experience. Now you're lying on cats and dogs. This is the entire gamut. He did not. Again, he said that he was Jewish and his ancestors fled the Holocaust. He is not Jewish. I repeat, his ancestors were not Jewish, and they did not, because of their non-Jewish position and stance, they did not flee any Holocaust. Now, that's delicate for any Jew, any Hebrew person. But these people, because of the white skin privilege, and nobody says anything. Remember, we're supposed to be the light of the world, not of the church. We're supposed to shine a light of truth in these overwhelming havens of darkness where lies are born and ingested. He said he, quote, lost four employees, end quote, at the 2016 Pulse nightclub shooting in Orlando. The New York Times found no evidence to support that claim. His financial assertions have proved murkier. Santos crowed about a family fortune in real estate, but property records show no evidence of the 13 properties he claimed that the family owned. Records do show evictions. He says his family owns a conglomeration of property. No such property has been proven to exist. Instead, they've tracked this guy, has been evicted multiple times, and he has multiple credit card debt. He was also involved in a company that the SEC called a Ponzi scheme, though he denies wrongdoing. And he once spent nearly $700 at a clothing store, wait for it, using a stolen checkbook and a false name, according to court records in Brazil, where Santos once lived. And now he has a seat in the U.S. Capitol as a congressman from New York. Yet Santos claimed on federal financial disclosure forms last year that he was earning millions. He also apparently lent his campaign $700,000, nearly two-thirds of $1 million. It's not clear where that money came from. I'd like to give you three guesses, and the first two don't count. The competition of race establishes different sets of rules for ethnicities. The literal moving of the goalposts and the church don't say nothing about this kind of activity. You see, if we're the light of the world, we're supposed to correct these wrongs. As good percent of chance he's connected to someone's church or it was at some point of growth and development. Even if he grew up in Brazil, the truth lives in Brazil. God lives in Brazil. Now he's a problem for the United States, and chances are good he's affiliated with someone somewhere. Why aren't we taking a position? Allow me to do, wow, it's 7:30 now. Let me just throw this in here, and then I'll ask, and I'll have to get back to this next week. Well, I'm going to see how I have to do this. I might have to skip next week. I'll figure something out. I only want to hold you all for about an hour. I found an article, a piece that was written by UCF Today. It was in the UCF Today online. And UCF is the University of Central Florida. It's an opinion piece, Waking Up to Whiteness and White Privilege. See, truth shouldn't have a color. Yes, Sandra Smith, I agree. And hello to you, by the way. This should have been investigated before he, quote, qualified to run for public office. Absolutely. But this, I hate to play the race card, but race affects everything. And you're fooling yourself if you don't believe that it does. And if we are not teachers of truth regarding race, then we have no founding. If this had been a black man, if this had been a brown skinned person, man, there would have been there would be no way in the world these people would still be seated in Congress, even though the Congress had some problems, probably swearing in these new people until they have a seated Speaker of the House, which, you know, that debacle. Yes, Theresa Thomas, by whatever means necessary to advance to power. Absolutely. Kind of demand. I wonder if we can go and start our own country while stating we have millions to do so. Absolutely. This is crazy. But they were supposed to vet him, but he's white. Deborah Smith, you're correct. You're correct. He's white. He's white. And as long as these different rules apply, that was the intention of race as a definitive factor, as a defining point. Early in the 1700s, again, this country began to classify, to codify skin color based on the notion of capitalism. What groups will serve other groups? How can you economically profit based on the skin color? And this is why race became the designation of different ethnicities. You went from ethnic groups, you went from ethnicities, you went from nationalities, which was a good word, you went to race. And race was a very strategic way to group people so that they could compete, so that there would be different rules that would apply, starting at the top tier being white-skinned people to protect white-skinned privilege. Church said nothing about it. And all the way down to the blackest, the brownest, to the darkest hue of people, suggesting that the clearer the skin, the more intelligent the person, the more apt, the more natural inclinations to prosperity, to education, so forth and the like. And the darker the skin type became, the dumber just naturally they were. And dumbness, lack of ability to learn, was clumped with the darkness of skin. Big lie from the devil. Church said nothing about it, or very little, or didn't make enough of a fuss to deal with it. Theresa Thomas says the Congress will not unseat Santos. Republicans need his vote to maintain a majority. Absolutely. They played him to get so he started out being just as hypocritical as the rest. He decried the Speaker of the House. His name is escaping me now, whoever they elected after, what, 13 tries. And then he came back and supported them. Now, he won by narrow margin. So they need all of the supporters they can get to get the Republican, MAGA Republican causes pushed through. It's just that simple. So they don't care about principles, but the church is supposed to. Yes, Kevin McCarthy. Thank you. What can be done? UCF Today, this is an opinion piece, waking up to whiteness and white privilege. Thank you, Angela. Associate Professor Ann Gleig, G-L-E-I-G, who has taught about racism and white supremacy in religion for a number of years at this particular college. While individual white people are not to blame for policies that began before they were born, we are still benefiting, and she includes herself in that group. We are still benefiting from them at the often grave expense of Black Americans. I got to do that one more time. This is a white woman who has wrote an opinion piece as a professor at the University of Central Florida, and it's entitled Waking Up to Whiteness and White Privilege. She makes this statement. Please hear this. While individual white people are not to blame for policies that began before they were born, we, including herself, as a white-skinned person, are still benefiting from them at the often grave expense of Black Americans. That's the truth. That is the truth. That's the whole issue. That's what the church should. That's right, Pastor Jordan Farrington. Everybody stop right now. Just give me a thumbs up. Give me some kind of affirmation. Use an emoji. Type something in there. Have some interaction just right now. This is the issue. This is the issue. Seeing the undeniable truth of this, we must challenge rather than comply with white supremacy and work toward creating a country that is more livable for everyone. That's egalitarian truth, equity for everyone. Why doesn't that go hand in glove with the church's assignment for spiritual matters? After we get you born again and connected to God in the spiritual sense at the same time, or nearly just as almost in tandem, we should be bringing people into an awareness of their saltiness so they can salt the world. They can become aware of their light and light-giving capacities so they take light to shine in dark places. These two directives go hand in glove. Be born again, be light. Be born again, be salt. Affect the church. Be affected by the church, then turn around and affect the world, affect the globe. God is the God of heaven, and he's the God of earth. He did two things. That's the balance of God. I saw this, and you'll get this. Next week, I'll have to pick up at some point. I had to find a way to tie Dr. King in this in deference to his birthday, which is next Sunday, I think it is, so Monday. Will be our program and our time together. What are some specific ways? And I'm just going to give this to you. I'll end with this. And as far as our action agenda is concerned, remember I told you that it's no good to have a history lesson or a current events lesson and not allow our emphasis of study, right, to impact us with an action or an action plan. That's one thing we've done. We've talked about January 15th, Sunday. Yes, that's his birthday, Theresa Thomas. So that's next Sunday, I think it is. Yes, that will be next Sunday. the birthday of Dr. King. He was born in, give me his birth date, because I think he would have been like, what would his age be by now? Anyway, let me finish this. Allow me to finish this. Here's our action agenda. I'll just give it to you as a couple of bullet points, a few bullet points very quickly. 1929, so he would have been 93. He will be 94 this year. He'll be 94 this year, if my math is correct. 94. Wow. Dr. King would have been age 94 this coming Sunday, January 15th. Now you'll correct me if my math is off, but I think it's correct. All right. What are some specific ways? Watch this now. Please hear this. I'm wrapping this up. What are some specific ways white people can recognize and take responsibility? Thank you, Connie. For white supremacy. How can we give an action plan to help educate our white brothers and sisters whom we love, white evangelicals, as many of us are? We believe in Jesus Christ as the King, by whom we are saved and through whom we inherit the benefits and the merits of salvation while we are here. And in as far as it relates to the life to come, Jesus is the door to everlasting life. And it's as simple as I can make it on short notice. Thank you, Theresa Thomas. While we're here, part of our assignment is to educate people who have white skin of their responsibility to help turn the tide, to first of all, be educated about what white privilege is, that it does exist, that racism is real, ignorant but real. Segregation, discrimination are real cousins and they are impactful in the earth, and that it is a hindrance for people of color to have been let go at the close of the Civil War with the signing of the Emancipation Proclamation circa 1863 or so, all the way till now. To release the slaves is one thing, but to release them penniless with barely the clothes on their back, and then to have the vestiges of that we face every day, and no one has said it, no one wants to talk about it. Okay, how do we allow the descendants of those plantation owners, those white-skinned people who have enjoyed white privilege because of the impacts of enslavement and so forth, how do we educate them and say, okay, here's what you can do. This is where I am tonight. Okay, listen to this. We can educate ourselves on systematic racism and white supremacy. We don't need to stick our head in the sand and say this doesn't exist, or I'm not going to have anything to do with this because it sounds like hate to me. It sounds like black supremacy and white inferiority. I'm not talking about either one. I don't believe in supremacy, or nor do I believe in inferiority. But the truth is, there is a movement, and always has been in this country, of systemic racism and white supremacy. So we need education. We need to understand what it looks like. We need to be able to say, this is truth. That is white supremacy. That is white privilege. And it comes out of systemic racism. We need education. We need education. We can't play like this doesn't exist. I told you once I was diagnosed with cancer, I could not pretend that cancer did not exist, even though I didn't feel it. It was early detected. And I saw the graphs after the MRIs, after the biopsy, after all the tests were run. I could not ignore it. And this country we have to be able to perform biopsies on racism. Oh, that's good. And once the biopsy has been performed, and perhaps it already has been in many instances, many times over, then what are the treatments? How are we going to deal with it? Or are you going to ignore it? Yes, being in denial is not the answer, Edna Campbell. Thank you. Theresa Thomas, stop the ostrich syndrome. They don't want to educate because they think already they're right and knowledgeable. Yes, Connie Demand, I agree. Secondly, white people can participate in anti-racist training programs. Get white people as well as black people to A, become educated about systematic or systemic racism and white supremacy. B, encourage white people to involve themselves in anti-racist training programs on your job, in the workplace, in the church, in the community. Get involved. Because when you recognize it, taking a stand is the next piece. If you're not willing to take a stand, then you got a situation. Then letter C, commit to having difficult conversations with white family and friends about systemic racism. Commit to talk about it, white people. That way you can retrieve other family members' heads from the sand, like an ostrich, because it isn't impacting them, but it's impacting our culture. Letter D, white people can be encouraged to join multiracial organizations, such as showing up for racial justice. Join. Put your money where your mouth is. If you say you see it, now it's time to do something about it. I like what someone said, Stephen Wash, first bind the strong man of hatred and loose unity, then confront in the natural. Yes, I agree. We've been doing that. And I like the fact that you connected the spiritual and the natural. We've been doing the spiritual part. We've been doing that. We've been praying, but faith without works is dead. Being alone, there has to be corresponding action. So the church has that part, man. We are hands off, but we are heavily involved in prayer. I doubt if we pray much about the racial piece because, you know, it's like if we pretend it doesn't exist, then it'll go away. When the black part of the church, bronze and brown part of the church, are the ones drastically being affected. I'm saying, along with that, which we've already been doing, we need to become people of action. The next one, letter E, I want to say, partner with black organizations. Now, that's going to take some bold white people right there. If you want to, for lack of a better word, make up for some of the things that your forebears, if you say you see it, and if the truth is the truth, be encouraged to partner with black organizations. What can we do as white-skinned people? You see, when the civil rights movement enjoyed, for lack of a better word, the successes that it did, it was because white people were stirred when they saw the children of the civil rights movement in Birmingham, Alabama, marching for their freedoms, being arrested, being jailed, dogs being turned loose on them, water hoses being turned loose on them. When the white world saw it, then they became active. Many of whom began to speak out. Many of whom came to Birmingham, Alabama, and other southern cities to take part in black organizations, to support causes that would infiltrate the mindset of this filthy spirit of racism that has infiltrated the church. And then finally, our action plan tonight, and I close with this, white people can be encouraged to support black businesses. I said it. When white people begin, see, we've been supporting their business. Black people in America have something to the tune of, $1.5 trillion spent in the economy. That's more than many third world countries as a whole. We just don't spend with each other. So if we could get white people to do what we've been doing for them, doing for us, getting them to do for us, as I'm trying to say, doing for us economically, what we've been doing for them forever. You burned our businesses down during the massacres across this country. And so the fledgling black businesses that we do have, what would happen if you had people who, because of church affiliations and the teachings of Jesus Christ, come into an understanding, say, okay, I'm going to partner with black organizations. I know I'm white skinned. I know I've been enjoying white privilege, but it's time to do something about it. Now I'm going to start supporting black owned businesses. Man, when the money begins to change, then the actions will begin to change. It was when Dr. King led the bus boycott in 1959, I want to say, 1959, the bus boycott of Montgomery, Alabama. And black people said, "We, since Rosa can't sit in the front, since you arrested her," this young 25-year-old Baptist minister said, "Okay, we know what we have to do." 1955, I was 1 year, what did I say, 59? 1955, thank you. Theresa Thomas. They said, okay, we're just going to become neighbors with each other, black people, and we're going to start driving. Every probably five families had a car, maybe even a larger group. Maybe every 10 families, black families, but we're just going to drag and pack each other in each other's cars. And instead of buying bus tokens and paying money to ride the buses went empty. I forget how long it took, but I think it was like a year or something like that, that these black people were committed to taking their black dollars out of white bus owners' pockets. And white bus owners said, "Whoa, wait a minute. We might not like black, bronze, and brown people, but we do like the color green. So what does it take, black, bronze, and brown people, to get you back on our buses so we can enjoy green dollars?" Yeah, that's what I thought. December 1st, 1955 through 1956. So that's a proverbially speaking, Edna Campbell, just stop riding the buses. What Montgomery did in 1955 through 1956, we should stop riding the buses in 2023, and we should get white people to start riding our buses. And I'm using that as a buses as a metaphor. If you say your heart has truly changed, show me that in economic reforms via church teachings. Somebody came to me once and they said, "Pastor Matthews, I know Jesus is coming soon." I said, "How do you know Jesus is coming soon?" They said, "Well, Jesus is coming soon. Don't you see all of the black people that are attending white mega churches?" And I know my face was contorted because I was thinking about all kinds of crazy stuff. But I tried to sift through the library of my mind to find a good way of expressing myself and not being offensive. I said, "Jesus is not coming soon based on that." I said, "We've been going to their churches if they let us in forever. We always have plantation Negroes who have to have acceptance by white people." I said, "We had that when we had the house Negro versus the field Negro, when we had those who were watching over the field Negroes to go and tell master what was going on. We've always had that. We've always had black-skinned people who needed white-skinned verification to be who they are. They only think they're good when white validates who they are. And we've always had those sellouts." I said, "But Jesus is coming soon when white people start supporting black leadership. when we can go over to white-led ministries and we're more than the entertainment. I don't know what's wrong with black people. We're more, we always been their entertainment. Can you listen to me teach? Can you watch my business moves in church? Can you learn from me like I've been learning from you? You see, that's always a problem when your oppressor becomes your teacher. When your oppressor is your teacher, then the oppressor will control how much information he allows you to learn. But when you become the teacher to your oppressor, then you can familiarize the oppressor with the experiences of the oppressed, so that now the oppressor becomes sensitive to that which he has created. That's what's supposed to happen. No one wants to talk to me. All right. So needless to say, that was a short-lived conversation. I'm closing with you tonight. It was business philosopher Jim Rohn who said, sincerity is not to test the truth. We must not make this mistake. He must be right. He's so sincere. It is possible to be so sincerely wrong. We must judge sincerity by sincerity and truth by truth. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7 gives us the balance of God. He says in his writings, just as it is, there is a time to be silent, there's also a time to speak. Some would say silence is golden. To them, I would say only until one's family and friends are negatively affected by wrongdoing. Others would say silence is great. To them, I say until someone's voice is necessary to save your life or corroborate your innocence. Silence is compromise. Silence is complicity with erroneous thinking. Silence is agreement with sanitized history. Silence is co-signing with control, racist, bigoted, and supremacy mentalities. Silence is equity and fairness in reverse. Silence robs supremacy of ever hearing truth and having the opportunity to change. Silence is the voice of continuous ethnic mistreatment. Silence validates inferior treatment. Silence is the approval of being objectified and maligned. Silence is often mistaken for agreement and consent. Silence is the devastation of a child being uncontrolled, untrained, and undisciplined by its silent parents. Silence is the ostrich syndrome. Silence is one level of maintaining and perpetuating cloaked ignorance. Black, bronze, and brown children must know how to correctly respond to racism, which they can only know when we are not silent. Truth does not, I emphasize and reemphasize, truth does not require error to be silent, to be in control. Error, however, requires the silence of truth to take control of any situation. And I told you at the beginning of the program, I was thinking about this the other day, that there is no crime in speaking out. The real crime is seen when the truth is withheld in silence. As you all are going out, please give us an emoji, give us a thumbs up, give us a closing comment. And when you come back and visit this program on the restream, or if you visit it on YouTube or as a podcast, whatever, make sure and comment after the stream. It also helps us to grow the channel. I thank you all so much for your time. I love you all. And remember, we're here each Monday, all other things being equal, 6:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, and we can never afford to be silent again. Blessings and peace to you and yours. Thank you.
Let it resound loud as the roar.